the program?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We at NAC conduct series of webinars for the benefit of all stakeholders and all higher education institutions. We are conducting series of theme-based webinars. Today's program is teaching learning process. We have with us Dr. Pratibha Singh, Deputy Advisor at NAC, Dr. Manjunath Rao, Deputy Advisor at NAC, Dr. Ruchi Tripathi, and Dr. Vijay Pandey, Assistant Advisor at NAC. I am Professor Amiya Kumar Rath, Advisor at NAC. I'll be taking 15 to 20 minutes, followed by Dr. Ruchi Tripathi, Pratibha Singh, Manjunath Rao, and Nilesh Pandey. Let me share my slides. Is my slide visible, Pratibha ji? Okay. Yes, teaching learning process. I'll be covering on legacy of higher education in Bharat, traditional teaching and modern concept, teaching learning, why there is a change. Now we have changed from face-to-face teaching learning to online teaching learning. Little bit focus on outcome-based education, not much. We talk about Bloom's taxonomy and in innovative teaching techniques. Of course, innovative teaching techniques will be detailed, elaborated by our colleague. Intelligence, I'll talk about intelligence, what is the research people have done in intelligence, and theory of multiple intelligence. Look at this, these are all development in the world. This is a masterpiece of development. It's a channel bridge over river Alpe and joins the former East and West Germany. It's part of the unification project. It's located in the city Berlin. It's open to public on April 23rd, 2011. Another development you can see, according to Guinness World Records, the world's longest bridge over water. It has around 5,000 pillars, opened in public in 2011. It's Jiangsu Bay Bridge, 42.5 kilometers. Similarly, the development tallest bridge in the world, which has 343 meters, which is located in France. Boeing 787, it's again a contribution to the world. Initiatives at Ambuja Cements, a novel way of transporting limestone. Conveyor belt running through three hills. The idea of showing this is all the development. You know, if you talk about legacy of higher education in Bharat, we had these ancient universities, like 8 ancient universities of Bharat. We have Takshila, we have Nalanda, we have Vikramshila, we have Pushpagiri, we have Anantapuri, Jagdala, Somapura, and Vallabhi. These are all our ancient universities in the world, in Bharat. You know, Nalanda, of course, it was situated in Bihar, mostly devoted for Buddhist studies. It has trained students in fine arts, medicine, mathematics, astronomy, politics, and the art of war. It has 10,000 students with 2,000 professors. In 2014, Nalanda Universities was launched nearby Rajgiri. Similarly, Pushpagiri, again in Odisha, in Cuttack. Takshila, it was mostly Hindu and Buddhist center of learning. Similarly, Vikramshila, of course, Takshila is famous, perhaps known because of its association with Chanakya. Then Vikramshila, these are all our ancient universities. We lost true wealth of knowledge due to many invasions on Bharat, from birthplace of Veda to striving to be just literate. You know, in 1950, post-independence, the government of India appointed a planning commission to prepare a blueprint for the development of different aspects of life, including education. The main goal of this plan which was set up in 1950 was to achieve universal elementary education and to eradicate illiteracy, to establish vocational and skill development training programs, to upgrade standards and modernize all stages of education with special emphasis on technical education, science, environmental education, morality, and relationship between school and work, to provide facilities for high quality education in every district of the country. Since then, many efforts are being done to improve the quality of education, but very less has been achieved for standardization of higher education, for its quality and compatibility to meet societal needs as well as global challenges. To address the issues in deterioration in quality of education, in the recommendation of National Policy on Education 1986 and the Program of Action 1992, NAAC was established in the year 1994 as an independent national accreditation body with a vision to make quality the defining element of higher education in India through a combination of self-evaluation, external evaluation, promotion and sustenance initiatives. And our mission is periodic assessment and accreditation of higher education institutions, promotion of quality of teaching, learning and research, encourage self-evaluation, accountability, autonomy and innovations, to undertake quality related research studies, consultancy and training programs, to collaborate with other stakeholders of higher education for quality evaluation, promotion and sustenance. Our value framework, guiding element for assessment and accreditation process, is contributing to national development, fostering global competencies among students, inculcating value system among students, promoting the use of technology and quest for excellence. You know, with this higher education, the committee has been set up in 1948 after this Dr. Chairmanship of Dr. S. Radhakrishnan in 1948, the first national policy on education. Now, after 34 years, you can see the National Education Policy 2020, it has been introduced. It's a comprehensive document covering all aspects of education. It focuses on creative thinking, improving the creative thinking of the students, critical thinking of the students, high order cognitive capacities such as critical thinking and problem solving. It talks about, see, the most important point is, it talks about the world is undergoing rapid changes in the knowledge landscape with various dramatic scientific and technological advances, advances in big data, machine learning and artificial intelligence. Many unskilled jobs will be taken over by the machines throughout the world. So it's very important to create skilled workforce in the area of mathematics, computer science, and data science, in conjunction with multidisciplinary abilities across sciences, social sciences, and humanities. That will be of greater demand. The policy document has been covered school education, higher education, other key areas of focus, and making it happen. It talks about a lot of changes. It talks about, I hope most of you might have read this particular documents, revamping the integrity of faculty members, then revamping the curriculum, revamping pedagogy-based teaching, revamping the assessment and student support for enhanced student experiences, and all that. So we have seven different criteria. I will not go detail into those criteria. I'll focus on teaching learning process, curricular aspects, teaching, learning, and evaluation, research, innovations, and extension, infrastructure and learning resources, student support and progression, governance, leadership, and management, institutional values, and best practices. These are the core criteria which NAAC evaluate or NAAC assess the institutions. We expect curriculum, how the curriculum is to be delivered to the students, how you prepare the curriculum and all that. Okay, the highest education is that which does not merely give us information, but makes our life in harmony with all existence, said by Rabindranath Tagore. then thinking is always a progress. Non-thinking is stagnation of mind, stagnation of individual, stagnation of organization and the country. Thinking leads to action. Knowledge without action is useless and irrelevant. Knowledge with action converts adversity into prosperity. So Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam used to say, the best brains of the nation may be found on the last benches of the classroom. You know, we teach a subject not to produce a little living librarians on that subject, but rather to get a student to think. Of course, National Education Policy 2020 talks about that. Students should think for himself to consider matters, to take part in the process of knowledge getting. Knowing is a process, not a product. Jerome Bruner, in his book on Towards a Theory of Instruction, he said that in the 21st century, it's an age of information. It's an age of knowledge economy that values problem solving and critical thinking. Information age, knowledge economy, problem solving, critical thinking is the age of 21st century. Talks about, you know, you might have seen the smart glasses. You might have seen the development of augmented realities, development of virtual realities, development of smart watch. Okay, what is traditional education? So pre-technology education is, teacher is the sender or the source of information. Educational material is the information or messages to be transmitted from the source to the destination. Student is the receiver, receives the information. What is the delivery medium? Delivery medium is chalk and talk methods, or some faculty members, they use projectors. Chalk and talk and projectors is the delivery medium which transmitted, which will be used by the sender to give the information to the receiver. Sender is the faculty members and receiver is the student. In such a case, if you look at the history, in such a case, students purely plays a passive role and their concentration fade off after 15 to 20 minutes. They lose their concentration after 15 to 20 minutes. It's very essential that faculty has to apply different teaching methods in the classroom. Faculty students should participate in the classroom. They should not play a passive role. Teachers delivers the lecture content. Learning mode is almost passive. Conventional learning approaches. You know, we need to, the traditional methods of teaching, always faculty members, they use chalk and talk. You know, you can look at this. Earlier, teacher was only the source of knowledge. You might have seen the movie Three Idiots. How the faculty will teach in that class. Something has been explained in the movie Three Idiots, what is important for students. Most of the time, students are silent. You know, I'll ask a simple questions like whether you want teaching or learning. The answer is always learning. We want learning to happen in the classroom. We ask you whether you want active learning or passive learning. The answer is active learning. If I ask you one more question, whether you want active learning or interactive learning, the answer is interactive learning. Interactive learning should happen in the classroom. For interactive learning, the faculty has to do a major role to make the students participate in the classroom. So, limitations is, teaching in classroom using chalk and talk is only one way flow of information. Teachers often continuously talk for an hour without knowing students' response and feedback. The material presented is only based on lecture notes and textbooks. There is insufficient interaction with students in classroom. More emphasis has been given on theory without any practical and real lifetime situation. Learning for memorization but not understanding. Yeah, we must help students to connect new ideas to what they already know. It's very important that construct their own new knowledge, apply the new knowledge in ways that are different from the situation in which it was learned. Core teaching skills, you know, there are 8 core teaching skills: skills of introducing a session, skill of explaining, skill of illustrating with examples, skill of questioning, skill of using blackboard is important, skill of reinforcement is important, skill of stimulus variation is important, and skill of probing questions are important. You know, if you talk about, say, there are 5 aspects of teaching styles. What type of information is emphasized? It's concrete or abstract? What is the mode of presentation, whether it's a visual presentation or it's a verbal presentation? What is the presentation organized, deductive or inductive? What mode of student participation is facilitated, whether it's active participation or passive participation? What is the type of perspective which provided on the information presented, whether it's sequential or global? You know, this multiple intelligence tells us to use all the sense of stimulate our brain and make the connections. If you look at this, change always, doing something new can be embarrassing. Doing something new can be embarrassing. Change is not very comfortable. Change involves unlearning. Change involves relearning. Change can be incorporated through acceptance and perhaps a little practice. So what I mean to say is, this is not very comfortable that we teach in a digital platform. Sitting before a laptop, talking for hours together is not very comfortable. But we have unlearned and we have relearned the way of teaching using online. You know, outcome-based education is important. Is organize the curriculum, delivery mechanism, and assessment. If curriculum, delivery mechanism, and assessment is properly maintained or properly organized, surely the learning happens. In outcome-based education, we talk about what students should be able to do, then prepare the curriculum accordingly, how to make the students achieve the outcome, then how to measure, that is assessment. Outcome-based education, outcome-based curriculum, outcome-based learning and teaching, then outcome-based assessment. So if you talk about enhancing the thinking levels of our learners, Benjamin Bloom says, education should focus on mastery of subjects rather than promotion of higher forms of thinking, rather than a Euclidean approach to simplify transferring facts. We need to take a student from one level of understanding, one level of thinking to another level of thinking. We take a student from remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, creating, and evaluating. So if you look at simple examples, if I take an example from engineering, if you ask what is state Ohm's law, without understanding, students can reproduce in the examinations just by hearting or remembering it. If you want to know whether they have understood or not, if you ask a formula, I equals to V by R, explain how I equal to V by R works, then understanding comes. Apply Ohm's law for solving a given problem, that's applying. Similarly, analyzing is a circuit diagram, a complex circuit diagram is given. You need to analyze and find out what is the current flow in 6 ohm resistors. So whenever we ask questions in the examinations, we should see that there should be some questions from high order thinking skills. There is another example from physics. Yeah, course outcomes are important. So what is important is program outcomes. We need to, at the end of a program is BSc Computer Science is a program. BTech Electronics and Telecommunication is a program. After completing the program, what is the knowledge, skills, competencies, behaviors, and attitude of the students? It is the duty of the college institution to see that students should possess those attributes that has been defined. Knowledge of science and engineering and other disciplines, specific areas, problem analysis, design and development of solutions, investigation of complex problems, modern tool usage, responsible to society, environment and sustainability, professional ethics, individual and teamwork and communications, project management and finance, and lifelong learning. These are all attributes which has been defined. students should inculcate those attributes when they complete their education. Yeah, I'll just skip some of the slides. Yeah, these are the things. Will not cover this. Yeah, I'll not cover this. So a blueprint of a faculty member is good motivations, industrial exposure, enhanced teaching learning process. Outcome is consistency in performance, better content delivery, and involvement in research. Blueprint of a student is competency-based curriculum, state-of-the-art laboratories, faculty members, good faculty, they should get good ambience. Outcome is academically sound, soft skills, professional approach, and diversified competencies. Similarly, blueprint of teaching learning processes, modern teaching aids, need-based curriculum, improved and person-independent evaluations. Output is higher acceptability, concept clarity, learning to learn skills and diversified competencies. So always there is a paradigm shift. Tell me and I will forget. Show me, I will remember. Involve me in the classroom and I will understand. The faculty needs to involve the students in the classroom in the learning process. So what is important is there are multiple intelligence shared by Gardner. David Howard Gardner is important. It says in his book Frames of Mind in 1983, it says, an intelligence is the ability to solve problems or to create products that are valued within one or more cultural settings. Some students are linguistic intelligence, they are word smart. Some of them are logical and mathematical intelligence, they are number smart. Some of them are spatial intelligence, they are picture smart. Some of them are bodily and kinesthetic intelligence, body smart. Musical intelligence, some of them are music smart. Interpersonal intelligence, some of them are pupil smart. Intrapersonal intelligence, self smart. And naturalistic intelligence, nature smart. And existential intelligence. So we need to understand what is the prominent intelligence in a student and what is the least intelligence in a student. We need to apply the prominent intelligence to improve the least intelligence. Yeah, it's important that more interactive, more participatory, more engaging, and more involving. So expectation from future graduates is know everything, do anything, work with anybody, anywhere, imagine and make it a reality. Faculty needs to be always updated in the latest technology, updated syllabus, keeping pace with the technological scenario of the world. Project-based learning, more emphasis should be given to the practicals. Every theory should be linked with the practicals. Good teaching is one that is well-planned and where activities are interrelated to each other. One that provides learning experiences or situation that will ensure understanding, application, and critical thinking. One where the learner is stimulated to think and reason. What makes a good teacher? Enthusiasm, eagerness, preparedness, punctuality, support, and show concern for students, consistency, politeness, firmness, and control provides personal help. Do not criticize students and lose their face. Be humble, fair, uses variety of learning activities. Has a sense of humor, allow funniness and jokes. Does not teach from a sitting or leaning position. Good interpersonal relationship with students. Employ an effective delivery methods. Keep accurate records of work completed, attendance, test results, and students' grade. Faculty has to have a different role. Guide, faculty can be a guide, counselor, researcher, strategy planner, coordinator, friend, problem solver, role model, mentor, assessor, planner, experimenter, facilitator, negotiated all those roles a faculty needs to play in the classroom. Okay, these are all my, yeah. So what is important is, there are some reactive and proactive. Reactive is, I'll be happy when I have a full establishment. If only I had a boss who was not, if I had respect from students, if I could just have management days, if the environment was more conducive. I'll just try to be proactive. Proactive is I can be a better role model. I can be more organized, resourceful. I can be more loving, understanding. I'll be more diligent. I can seek out personal and be able to understand. Try to be always proactive. To achieve quality, we need to work together, collaborate with others, tolerate differences, respect diverse views, because none of us is as smart as all of us. In life, it is not most talented who survive, nor the most intelligent, but the ones who are most responsive to change. And the real change can happen only when you listen to your inner voice, the intuition, and it is never too late. Take risks in your life. If you win, you can lead. If you lose, you can guide. Thank you. Namaskar. Okay. Over to...
Yes, sir. I'm here, sir.
Suruchi Tripathi.
Yes, thank you. Habib, please give me a share button. I think my PPT is visible.
Visible, Ruchi. Make it full screen and go ahead.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir, for your nice presentation, a beautiful presentation regarding the teaching and learning in higher education. And good afternoon to one and all present here today. Now, discuss about the teaching and learning in higher education. As you all know, we have the second criteria, as Amir sir is discussed with. With reference to this criteria, what we have the key indicator, with reference to the key indicator, this is total presentation what we are going to do, all the team that is based on this. So now I'm going to moving about the teaching learning in higher education. You know, the teaching and learning are the two sides of the coin, and the present qualitative studies aims to investigate effective teaching in the higher education. And based on the several study, the base teaching approach is mix of the students centered together with the teacher centered, along with the educational planning and the previous readiness. In higher education, the faculty strives to become a more effective teachers so that student can learn better many methods to improve their teaching practices depending on the nature of the subjects and on the number of the students. Teachers would also spend the sufficient time, the preparing of the process and step of the discussion. As Amir sir, it is explained in presentation, the lot of methods, how you have to create your ideas in when you are delivering the lectures. So that is also important, and focus based on the topic and the parameters, and student participation should also very much important with reference of the this. Now, moving ahead, we'll discuss about the concept of the teaching method. We have taken some methods for maybe it helpful for you all. If you have anything, you also can discuss after the presentation in question answer session. Using previous knowledge, it's based on the all the experience. Experience is very much important topic and very much key role of the anything we are going to deliver as a form of the teaching method. The previous knowledge is used to bring the written word to life to make it the more relevant to the student mind. Also, the individual difference is depend on the nature of the students. Individual difference. What is the level of recognition, level of cognitive effective behavior, and student's trait, different kinds of behavior, what the individual students have. Readiness is very much important to starting from where we are going to teach, what material we are going to deliver, and where you are going to finish, and what are the outcomes of this material. Meaningfulness, objective of the lesson, what topic we are going to cover, that is what is the objective, what is the parameter, and simple to comprehend. When we are going to teach in the classroom, it is also important to simple to the complex. Yes, we are starting from the easy. Then once the students are going to recognize the things are easy, then immediately we'll come to the complex. Concentrate to the abstract, not hold the theory. That's why student is not going to confuse about what they are listening in the class. General to the specific and known to the unknown. So this is basic small concept of the teaching method that today I'm going to discuss in my presentation. Let us move about the teaching method. You know, the teaching method do not treat all the student at the same level of their understanding abilities and also the convenience method of the teaching. Basically, the teaching methods focus more on the questioning, demonstration, exploring practical call, collaborations method, and also the very much activity based teaching. If you're talking about the innovating teaching or the modern teaching, the ability to adopt the new knowledge in the science and technology, what Abhi sir discussed in the presentation, like Ohm's law and other law, and also needs for the innovations and creative mind to explore the unknown and unrevealed areas of the different fields. So this is the method. Now I'm moving ahead. I will discuss about the teaching method overview. You know, the teaching method refer to the general principle, pedagogy and management strategy used for the classroom instruction. Yes, this is very much important. As you know, our first key indicator of the second criteria is also talking about the this thing. So this is the, what is the syllabus, what is the pedagogy is there. It is a set of principle, beliefs, ideas about the nature of learning, which is translated into the classroom. And also the methods, teaching method is depends on the educational philosophy of the classroom, demographics, subject area, and school mission and treatment depends on the different kinds of the subjects. Teaching method and curriculum in colleges and universities are changing in response to the new demand on higher education. As you know, our NEP, National Education Policy, also demanded the outcome-based educations, that is also referred to the new demand of the education. And many of the innovation involved a move towards a more student-centered approach to the teaching, where the role of teacher is not to the transfer knowledge to the student, but the facilitate student to construct their own knowledge. So moving ahead, this is basic teaching method overview. Now discuss about that some methods in brief. First is the teacher-centered method of the instruction. As you know, the teacher-centered method, this is teachers serve the instructor and authority and deliver the knowledge to their students through the lectures mode, direct instruction, and aim to the, what are the aim of the teaching method is measure the result through the testing and the assessment. And this method is sometimes referred to the stage on the stage. So this is the teacher-centered method. Teacher is fully involved in the process of the teaching approach. Let us discuss about some of the examples, some of the types of the teacher-centered method. So I'm just taking first direct instruction. The direct instruction is the teacher convey knowledge to their students mainly through the lectures and written lesson plans without factoring in student preferences or opportunity, hands-on, another also type of the learning material. And this method is also help to the low technology. They may use the low technology and relies to text and workbook rather than the computer and the mobile devices. This is very much important for the direct instruction. Now we are going to, basically people are focusing the high tech based education, high tech based of the teaching and learning. No problem. This is very much interesting and enthusiastic, and everything is it may be the fruitful. But direct instruction, the traditional method, is also the similarly involvement in the learning of anything, learning and teaching of the everything. So there is a pros and cons of the direct that traditional method and modern method. Now moving ahead, the second part is the flipped classroom. This is high technology, but it is come under the teacher centered method. Students watch and read their lesson on computer at home. Nowadays, it is very much important. Due to the COVID, this method is very useful, and then complete assignment and do the problem solving exercise in the class. As you know, if you are talking about the class, school or the college in higher education or in professional courses, nowadays every students or every children's are they are study with the help of the flipped classroom study, recorded lectures, recorded videos, and all this come under the flipped classroom. Now moving ahead, this is the next is the kinesthetic learning. This is low tech. This is what is this actually? This is the basic definition of this learning is value movement and creativity over the technology skills is most commonly used to augment traditional types of the instruction. The theory being that requires students to do, make or create something, exercise different learning muscles. So this is the kinesthetic learning. This is basically if in classroom we are going to prepare or explain the presentation and doing the presentation, we need some kind of movement, we need some kind of expression for the deliberation of the lecture. So now I'm moving ahead. This is second type. This is student-centered approach to learn. I just want to say one quote is here. You are able to see in this diagram, in this picture. If a single teacher cannot teach us all the subjects, then how could you expect a single student to learn all the subjects? So this is very important things. We, as a teacher, as academic, we think about this. And as in the mind, we have to teach in the, we have to, when we are going to teach in the class, we are ready for this. And we have to cooperate to students. We have to give the chance to the student. They learn and they innovate, they create, they think about this. Basically, in this, still the teacher serves as an authority figure, but many function more as a facilitator or the guide on the side. As the students assume a much more active role in the learning process. In this method, students learn from and are continually assessed on such activity as a group project, students' portfolios, and the class participation. So just let us take some types under the student-centric method. The first is the differentiated instruction. Again, this is the low technology-based method. Student learn based and then tailoring instruction to meet students' individual needs, and differentiated instruction to concentrate with the learning by the offering opinion, how the student access content and the type of activity they do to master a concept. How student learn about the essays and even how the classroom is set up. So this has come under the differentiation instruction, and it is based on different kind of students and different type of student, different nature of students and on. Now, the second is the inquiry based learning. In this, there is high technology used in this inquiry based learning. Teacher offers support and guidance as the students work on a project, and that depend on them taking on a more active and participatory role in their own learning. So this is very important. More active and participating learning is also used in the inquiry based, and the student may participate different projects, develop their own questions, this is based on the inquiry based questions, and the conducting research often using online resource, and then demonstrate that result and their work to the self-made videos, web pages, etc., and the formal presentation. So basically, the inquiry based learning is helpful to students to for the outcome based education or the for the placement or other things that is important. Now the third type is expeditionary learning. This is again the low technology based. In this learning, the based on the ideas that there is considerable educational value in getting students out of the classroom and into the real world, and can be used to augment such expedition by the primary focus is getting out the community for real world learning experience. And the fourth one is the personalized learning. The personalized learning is basically the teachers encourage to the students to follow the personalized self-directed learning plans, and inspired by their specific interest and skills. Already Amir sir discussed the different kind of skills. That skills is basically useful for the student in this method. So the student, since they has to they prepare the own pace and moving forward and spending the extra time is if they required. A teacher also offers some traditional instruction as well as online material. That's why they are good, that this method become a good output, good fruitful for the student when the changes and their the learning plans are the required. Moving ahead, the last is the game based learning. The game based learning, sometimes the students maybe feel like some out of the things they are not feel like in the class, they are studying or something like that. So we use some games, and it's based on the choice of students, based on the nature of the students. And the field of the game based basically requires the student to be a problem solver. They work as a quest or to accomplish specific goals, and also they blend together learning objectives with fun and earning points to be they are like video games and all. So this is the game based teaching method. Moving ahead, I am going to discuss about the high tech approach to learning and the low tech approach to the learning. You know, as high tech approach learning like laptops, tablets, using the internet. Now, if you are talking in this COVID-19 one and half year back, the whole study is the high tech based. And you know, the pros and cons is also there for high tech learning, either in the school class or if you're talking about the higher education or the professional courses. There is somewhat, this is the positive, somewhat this is also there is cons is also there, and positive advantage is also there. So this is the high class tech learning, and also that high class learning teachers utilize many different types of technology, depend on the what kind of teaching material they are going to present in the class. Low tech approach of learning, again I'm going to take that low technology also. The sometime we cannot say the high technology is always is a good, so low technology is also good. Why the low technology? Because as a academician, as a professor, as a assistant professor, associate professor, you know better. As a principal, you know better what are the difference basically the high tech and low tech teaching approach in their the classroom. We also see the NAAC criteria, NAAC second criteria, teaching learning approach. So we have mentioned the different kind of learning process along with the high technology means ICT and all. We also mentioned there the feedback system and outcome system, outcome, what are the student performance, students learning outcomes. So basically the over the mixed strategy, what I mentioned in starting of my presentation, the mixed strategy of student centric as well as teacher standing, and the mix of the high tech and the low tech approach. Apart from this method, student approach, teacher approach, we have also some of the method. As you know, I'm not going to take more time here. This is very small things, you know, the lecture method, group discussion, presentation, assignment, seminars, workshop, brainstorming, role play, case study. These are the other methods you can use as required, like assignment, project preparation, theoretical class, practical class, experimental class. So use as per requirement of this method and you go through. Some of the key teaching technique I want to discuss here, how to engage students, how to have the role play, and how to the variety of different kind of teaching presentation. And as you know, the active learning, as sir already mentioned, the active learning and passive learning, that is also important point when you are going to teaching and when you are going to adopt any method. Student teaching, students can teach each other the material in the classroom, review, evaluation. In the evaluation, my other senior colleague is going to discuss in detail to you in front of you. And feedback system. So these are the other techniques is used to make the teaching system and teaching style in the different way, giving the lecture, administrative style, demonstrator, each style, hybrid style, facilitator style, delegation, group style, inquiry based style that I mentioned, and Amir sir is also mentioned for the huge pool of the teaching classroom. Let us move about the teaching learning activity. So basically teaching learning activities aims to help students to attain the intended learning outcomes, what sir is mentioned, learning outcomes and program outcomes, and engage them in these learning activities through the teaching process. Also the student-centered approach is the emphasis on the outcome-based education. This is very much important to success and largely dependent on the extent to which students take responsibility for their own learning and whether or not cooperative learning is used. And this outcome-based education is usually related to the teaching learning skills, attitude, teamwork, cooperation. And that program and courses should also provide the experience that students are going to be encountered in the real world. Along with this, the activities teachers manage, the peer manage and self manage. These are the some of the teaching learning activities, how to select the teaching learning activity. So basically intended the learning outcomes and specify the context as a standard of the students to attain, and design the teaching learning assessment. Help of the students achieve in intended learning outcomes, what we decide in first process, and the design select the assessment teaching learning assessment task that the address to the learning outcomes, that the abilities you judge how much students have achieved, and construct the grading schemes and assessment criteria to judge students performance transformation. These are the teaching assessment things. In details my colleagues is going to discuss with you. Now I'm going to stop my presentation. If you have any query related to this, or you want to discuss anything, you want to add anything, we can discuss here. So now I'm going to stop my presentation. I just request my other colleague, please go through the next process. Namaskar.
Manjunath sir.
Yeah. Hey, good morning.
So are you presenting or?
Anyway,
huh?
Shall I do it?
I'll continue with the assessment and then you can.
Okay. Please, ma'am.
Okay. My slides are visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Make sure it's visible, ma'am.
Slides are moving, ma'am?
Yes.
Go ahead, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. In this particular session of teaching learning process, I would be discussing about the key drivers for the teaching learning process and how to make the teaching learning process more effective and what are the assessment methodologies used in order to improve the teaching learning process. I would be discussing about. So we have to start with the objectives of the higher education institutions. As we all know that the learning paradigm governed college, these are the few characteristics which are highlighted here, that the college must have identified its intended learning outcomes in detail. So all the institutions, we expect that the institution will be having their own objectives, and in order to meet out those objectives, there must be for each program run by the institution a preset defined learning outcomes. Secondly, it must have developed a system for measuring the achievements of these outcomes at both the individual student level, aggregate class level, program level, and institutional levels. So the measurement of these learning outcomes is also a very important component of this learning paradigm. Third is, the curriculum must have been built backward from the intended outcomes and must be developmental. That is very important. Generally, this is a top-down approach where the outcome is set first, and accordingly, in order to meet out those outcomes, the curriculum needs to be defined or needs to be continuously upgraded. The fourth, must provide a wide range of powerful options for achieving the required learning outcome. And how to achieve those learning outcomes, that is very important. So powerful options, like if something is not successfully working, what are the alternatives in order to achieve those learning outcomes? That also needs to be identified. Fifth and finally, it must be a continuous and systematic investigative alternative methods for empowering students. It should not be a one-time measure, it should be a continuous process. So as we all know that the educational experience of the students has got three key elements, the starting with the curriculum, how the curriculum is being transacted using pedagogy, and the assessments of the achievements of the students or the learners is also very important in order to make the learning more fruitful. So now, what are the factors which are affecting the learning of the pupil? So we all know that there are various factors because India is a diverse country and we have got various different kinds of higher education institutions. So some of the factors are listed out here. The socio-economic status of the family is very important. Their demographic location, the age, the income, medium of instruction, health and nutrition. These are some of the factors which has been listed out as a reason for affecting the learning of the people. Then the institution and the quality of teacher is also very important. What kind of institution is there and what is the quality of teacher the institution is having. Then the providing the opportunities for testing and feedback. So how the learning is taking place, whether it involves a continuous feedback from various stakeholders, that is very important. and also the academic environment, infrastructure, and instructional material used to transit the curriculum. So we all know that there are various assessment types for the higher education institutions, or some of them are listed out here. The first one is written mode, such as examinations, thesis, submission, article, submission, review, journal writing, case studies. In oral mode, we have Viva, group discussion, role play, rapid fire questions, etc. In practical mode, we have lab work, computer simulation. Nowadays, we are talking about the virtual lab. So people are moving towards the virtual reality and augmented reality. So that also can be searched out in this practical mode. Then craft work, and in integrated mode, we have presentation of papers, seminars, field assignments, poster presentation. So all these methods have to be integrated somewhere in your assessment methodology used for the curriculum. Then there are several assessment of a program has got certain principles. So these are some of the principles which are listed out, which the assessment should be following. The assessment of student learning begins with the educational values. Then the assessment is most effective when it reflects the understanding of the learning as in multidimensional. It should be a multidimensional, integrated, and revealed in the performance over the time. That means it should be continuously monitored. The assessment works best when the program it seeks to improve have a clear, explicit stated purpose. Assessment requires attention to outcomes, but also equally to the experience that lead to these outcomes. The assessment works best when it is ongoing and not episodic. It should not be a one-time process. Assessment fosters wider improvement when representatives from across the educational community are involved. Assessment makes a difference when it begins with the issues of use. Issues of use is very important and illuminates a question that people really care about. That means it should address the local context and the societal needs of the particular region. Assessment is more likely to lead to improvement when it is a part of larger set of conditions that promote change. Through assessment, educators meet the responsibility to students and to the public. Assessment is viewed as a comprehensive, systematic, and a continuous process. Assessment is viewed as a mean of self-improvement. Assessment measures are meaningful. Assessment utilizes multiple measures and multiple sources. Assessment is used as a management tool. Assessment results are valued and are genuinely used to improve the programs and processes. And assessment is coordinated by one person and reviewed by a committee. That is very important. It is coordinated by one person and reviewed by a committee. Assessment involves the participation and the input of all faculty and staff. And assessment includes students also. So this is the general thing about a program assessment. That's why there is a specific mention of all the kinds of stakeholders that are involved in this process. So assessment should not be viewed as an evaluation or accountability process. It should be accepted as being optional and be used to compare the programs. We all know that there are various types of learning assessments of learning for a people. So diagnostic assessment, what are the characteristics of diagnostic assessment? Diagnostic assessments are pre-test. These are basically assessed, the students are assessed before arranging for the programs, before beginning of the program. Their level of knowledge is tested. These tests happen at the beginning of unit, lesson, quarter of period of a time. These tests help to tell the teachers that the students how much they know and don't know about upcoming topics. This helps to improve the teacher's lesson planning, learning objectives, and identify the areas that many need more or less time to be spent on. These are used to identify these strengths and areas of improvement for the students. although these are very common methodologies which I have listed out here, but that is very important because these are the parts of our curriculum frame, our NAAC criteria. Formative assessment. Formative assessment is designated to assess the teachers and students in improving learning. So it is very important. It basically assists teachers as well. This assessment provides a student with a timely, specific feedback that needs to make the adjustment in their learning. It usually focuses on improvement compared with the student's previous best. It allows the teachers to monitor students on a day-to-day basis and modify their teaching learning if needed. Summative assessment, basically after the completion of the degree or the program, the summative assessment can be viewed as an end semester exam, annual exam, and so on. So summative assessments are designed for the information of those who are not directly involved in daily learning and teaching, in addition to the educators and other students. This type of assessment lets the teachers and students, their parents, to know how well each student has completed the learning task. It provides the information about the student's achievement. It usually compares the student's learning either with the other student's learning or the standards of the grade level. Another method is non-referenced assessment, in which it is the process of evaluating and grading the learning of the students by judging and ranking them against the performance of their peers. So this is very important, where the students is compared, the performance is compared with the peers, their own peers. What is the purpose of this assessment? It is used to discriminate between the high and low achievers. So sometimes we talk about the level of the achievement of these students. So this particular non-reference assessment may be used. Students compete against each other in this type of assessment. Each student's grade is determined in the part how well other students do in the same assessment task. This type of assessment, grade and marks are distributed according to the standard deviation curve. Criteria referenced assessment, specified preset criteria is there. In this process of evaluating and grading the learning of the students, again assess set of pre-specified criteria. Result of such tests are compared to written descriptors, what the students are expected to know at a particular stage. Each individual is compared with a preset standard. So for each criteria, there must be a preset standard that this is the achievement in this particular criteria, what we expect from the students. Criteria reference tests are used to understand and monitor the student's development as they pass from grade to grade. If the student do not seem to master a particular standard, the teacher will be able to get back and teach that standard again. So sometimes we talk about remedial measures. So remedial class, what is the remedial measure which has been taken up in order to empower the students to meet out these standards? Then the benchmark or interim assessments talks about. Benchmark assessment is basically should be taken periodically at the end of every quarter or as frequently as per month basis throughout an year to establish a baseline achievement of the data and measure progress towards a standard or the set of academic standard and goals. This type of assessment provides the teacher information about which content standards have been mastered and which require additional instruction, identifying student strengths and needs. This can also be used to measure the student's progress over time, and it is also used to determine whether the students are on track or performing well for the future assessment, such as standard test and of course exam. It helps in identifying the patterns in the student learning habits. Now, how to assess the higher order abilities, higher order skills of the pupil? So there are some methods which are listed out in order to test the higher order skills of the students. So these are as follows: course projects, open-ended experiments in lab, project-based learning modules, MOOCs, extracurricular experiences, mini and minor projects, final year projects, internship experience and e-portfolios of the student works. So we have all now progressing towards personalized learning experience or student-centric learning process. And a very important example is the of the assessment in those personalized experience is GMAT examination. So over 2 lakh people take GMAT every year. And what is the examination, how it is done? Ranking is done in the relative order of their abilities, that levels are identified and each level has got different set of questions. And once the student clears particular level, the question randomly is taken from the other level and thrown to the student for answering. So all students have been given a 3-hour examination time over which they will be given a question. And exhaustive question bank is the base for conducting this examination, and accordingly they will be assessed using adaptive learning assessment methodology. So we all know about this Bloom's taxonomy and how the learning outcomes, how mapping of the topic wise and questions are there and how it is assessed. So basically for a program, there are various courses, and for each courses, we have got different types of topics. In each topics, we have got content unit wise, and accordingly, the content is mapped to the learning outcome. So there are various questions, and answering those questions basically defines the achievement of the learning outcome. So of course, there are various modules which are there existing in the assessment methodology, how to relate questions, how with the learning outcomes, and what are the methodologies used for that. So that is a separate outcome based education, but this is general general layout of how the outcome based education happens. So the assessment is very important element for assessing the learning outcomes for the students. So based on the assessment of the examination questions and the performance indicators are used to assess, and this performance indicators are basically linked with the course outcomes, the attainment, and these course outcomes assessment is linked with the program outcome. So this is a sequential process in which starting from the content questions, we are leading towards the program outcomes. So program educational objectives we have to set first of all, and for each of the programs what we are running, a broader statements must be defined. So the word definition of the program educational objective, it is a broad statement representing the expected achievement of a graduate from a program and are supposed to be attained in a few years after graduation. So usually it is 3 to 5. Of course, these are the definitions which are taken from the Bloom's taxonomy of outcome-based assessment. So our regulatory bodies, various UGC and AICT, have come out with the evaluation reforms guidelines. One can refer those documents in order to meet out the requirements and in order to plan how to achieve the outcome-based education in their own context. So these evaluation reforms, the basis in the higher education institution focuses on the evaluation of students based on continuous assessment modes. The grading system, the assessment rubrics, these are basically guidelines on which the cognitive and psychometric skills are tested, and developing just based on the developing the exhaustive question bank for setting good quality question paper. Effective use of technology is very essential, and tools like rubrics or scoring guides for the assessment can be utilized to interpret the grades of the students on any kind of work against the criteria standards, thereby increase the objectivity and reduce the subjectivity in the assessment. So what are the key drivers for the examination reforms? Adaptation of the outcome-based education. Our NEP also highlights that education system should be outcome-driven, and growing concern about the quality and employability. Our skill report says 46% of our graduates are employable. So we have to improve the employability of the graduates. So this is very important and essential that our education system should be driven and based on the outcome based. The importance of higher order abilities and professional skills for employability of graduates is very important. So this is the process of adopting the outcome-based framework. First and foremost is the formation of the program, educational objectives and outcomes, mapping of the outcome through the curriculum, then design and deliver and align the teaching learning activities and assessing the attainment of outcomes. And this is a sequential and continuous process. Once one level is achieved, we have to move on in the ladder for the next level. So this is about the assessment for the outcome-based education and Bloom's taxonomy. There are different levels. Already sir has highlighted that these are the levels according to modified Bloom's taxonomy. And these are the methods of assessment, how it will be assessed. So these four levels, analyzing, evaluating, creating, and applying, will be assessed through the course projects, mini projects, minor projects, capstone project, and open-ended problem solving. While the lower levels can be assessed through fixed hour examinations. So like this, there are various assessment techniques for various levels of Bloom's. What are the motivating factors for students to learn? So what can be practiced in order to improve the teaching or learning of the for the student point of view? The enjoyment, so we have to try to incorporate these methods in our teaching day-to-day practices. The enjoyment of being able to solve tough technical problems. So it is not always a technical institution. This is important that we should be able to identify harder assignments, harder problems in our general education also, and try to give it to students in order to motivate them for the enjoyment of being able to solve. The desire to be able to make impressive things like buildings, space rockets, fast cars, and so on. The desire to make the positive difference to the world, for example, coming up with a cost-effective renewable energy system or designing a water recycling system. The desire to become professional with the status and financial security. The desire to outperform other students or in team, working with the teams of students. The demand on the learners and thus education system are evolving fast. In the past, education was able about only teaching people something. Now it is about making sure that the student develop a reliable compass and the navigation skills to find their own way through an increasingly uncertain, volatile, ambiguous world. So it is very important, reliable compass and navigation skills to find their own way. So earlier and the new present scenario is completely different, and accordingly we have to modify our teaching learning process. So this is the conclusion. To be effective, assessment should be integrated into the existing process, like planning, resource allocation, and catalog revision and program review. So that is very important, that its assessment should not be treated in isolation, and it should be integrated at the planning level, at the resource allocation level, and catalog revision and program review level. So this is all about the assessment and the importance of assessment in teaching learning process. Thank you very much for patient listening. Now I will hand back to the our deputy advisor, sir, to take the session ahead.
Thank you. Good morning, all the participants. This is Dr. L. Manjunath Rao,
Deputy Advisor, NAC, Bangalore. There are three modes of education, that is face-to-face teaching learning, that is regular education, open and distance learning education, which is passed by the parliamentary board, that is regulation 2017. One more, that is online courses of education, regulation 2018. There is a joint committee which is constituted by MHRD, which contains UGC, AICTE and Distance Education Bureau. All the three modes of education are recognized by Government of India. If any student who passes out from these three modes, they are eligible for both employment and education. Face-to-face teaching is a normal regular education. Open and distance learning education, which is passed the regulation in the year 2017. Online courses of education, the regulations are passed in the year 2018. There are government initiatives which are available, that is e-content for teaching learning in higher education. EPG Patashala, CEC undergraduate tool, it is Consortium for Educational Communication. There is a Swayam online MOOC course which is available, which is called Study Webs of Active Learning for Young Aspiring Minds, MOOCs. Massive Open Online Courses, NPTEL, National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, NMEICT, National Mission on Education Through Information and Communication Technology, Institutional LMS, that is Learning Management System. See, we have a criteria in the NAC. If any of the teacher who contributes e-content in one of these e-content teaching learning tools, they will be getting the score. For that, you have to give the details like name of the teacher who has contributed for the e-content development, name of the module, which module is developed by the teacher, platform on which module is developed, so whether they have developed in Swayam or in CEC or in NPTEL, whichever platform on which the module is developed, date of launch of e-content, when that e-content was launched online through the government initiative, number of platforms on which e-content has been developed by teachers. So there is Swayam MOOC course which is available, so which is Swayam India's own MOOC platform, online course on all disciplines like engineering, law, management, humanities, social sciences, and professional courses. Through this Swayam, for all the programs, the courses are available. It is designed to achieve the three cardinal principles of education policy, access. So it should be accessed by everybody from any place. Equity, irrespective of economical conditions, the users should be able to use it. And quality, the courses which are offered by the prestigious institution, the professors, they are offering it. Swayam is an indigenously developed cloud-based IT platform that facilitates posting of all the courses taught in classroom from 9th standard till post-graduation to be accessed by anyone, anytime, anywhere, free of cost. All the courses are interactive, prepared by reputed teachers in the country and accessible through computers and mobile phones. Swayam National Coordinators, UGC, PG Non-Engineering, all non-engineering programs, courses are offered by UGC, IIMB, Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore, all the management courses are offered by them, CEC, UG Non-Engineering, CEC, NPTEL, UG and PG Engineering, IGNO, Certificate and Diploma courses are offered. NITTR teacher training programs are offered. NCERT school 9th to 12th standard courses are offered. NIOS open school from 9th to 12th standard, they are offering it. AICTE annual refresher program in teaching, that is ORPIT and foreign universities. The key features of SWAYAM: credit transfer, up to 20% credit transfer facility available for the enrolled students. Necessary regulations issued by UGC and AICTE. Suppose if it is an engineering program, now the engineering program is 150 credits as per AICTE model curriculum. If out of 150 credits, 20%, that means 30 credits can be done through the SWAYAM platform or SWAYAM courses. Integration with the conventional education. Schedule of SWAYAM courses aligned with conventional semester to facilitate easy credit transfer. The higher education institutions shall offer SWAYAM courses along with the regular courses in their curriculum. Final proctored examination. The SWAYAM final proctored examination is conducted twice in a year, May and November, across the country in about 200 centers for both the computer-based test and pen and paper test. These SWAYAM courses are offered by the professors of prestigious institutions. Through these SWAYAM courses, we will be getting the content. So the chapter-wise or module-wise, we will be getting the content. For every module, they give the assignments and tests that we need to submit it. At the end of the course, they conduct the proctored exam. If we write the proctored exam, we will be getting the certificate, which is issued by Government of India, Ministry of Education. Online degree program. Top ranking universities to offer online degree program through SWAYAM. Now, there are three modes of education. That is regular education, distance learning program, and online degree program. The online degree programs are offered by the top 100 institutions in India, which they are offering through SWAYAM platform. Annual refresher program in teaching, that is ORPIT, faculty development program for 1.3 million teachers. The teachers can undergo faculty development program, which is conducted through the SWAYAM by AICTE, which is approved by AICTE and all the regulatory bodies. Global reach, SWAYAM courses being offered to African students in more than 20 African countries under the VBAP project of Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India. MOU signed with Afghanistan for sharing of SWAYAM courses. Next, SWAYAM Prabha. For DTH channel for education, SWAYAM Prabha is an initiative to provide 32 high quality educational channels through DTH, that is direct to home, across the length and breadth of the country, 24/7 basis. This would enable to deliver e-education in most cost effective and inclusive manner. SWAYAM Prabha is a free DTH channel, higher education curriculum based course contents at postgraduate and undergraduate level, IIT PAL, to assist the students in the class 11th and 12th aspiring to join IITs. School education 9 to 12 levels, modules for teachers training, as well as teaching and learning aids for children of India. Curriculum based courses that can meet the needs of lifelong learners of Indian citizens in India and abroad, freely available. Next, National Digital Library of India. National Digital Library of India, it's a virtual repository of learning resources with single window search facility. The higher education institutions can subscribe to this National Digital Library of India, which is available 24/7 learning resources. Accessible by anyone from anywhere and anytime. Single window search facility with filters through which users can personalize more than 3.8 crore ebooks, journals, audiobooks, question banks are available. Contents are available in 200 plus languages. 52 lakh plus registrations are done with this. Number of institutions 13,352. Next, virtual labs. In the pandemic situation, students are not coming to the higher education institutions to conduct the practicals. So there is a virtual lab initiative by Government of India. Virtual labs provides a fully interactive simulation environment to perform experiments, collect data, and answer questions to access the understanding of the knowledge acquired. In order to achieve the objectives of such an ambitious project, it is essential to develop virtual laboratories with state-of-the-art computer simulation technology to create real-world environments and problem handling capabilities. IIT Delhi, as the nodal institute with other 10 institutes, is understanding this initiative. Next, E-Yantra, promoting robotics as multidisciplinary engineering project, supporting innovation by students, learning by doing through group work, train teachers to teach engineering better. It's a project by IIT Bombay. E-Yantra is a project by IIT Bombay. E-Yantra lab set up initiatives, support infrastructure creation. If any of the higher education institution, they want to set up E-Yantra lab, that is a robotics lab. So through this project, you can get the assistance. E-Yantra competitions are held across colleges to create awareness. 296 labs established in 32 regions. Proposed to establish 500 plus labs. Over 2,115 teachers are trained. 5,932 total teams participated in E-Yantra robotics competition. Next, free and open source software in education. That is called FOSI project. Promotes the use of open source software in educational institution. It does through instructional material such as spoken tutorials, documentation, such as textbook companions, awareness program, such as conferences, trainings, workshops, and internships. Textbook companion is a collection of code for solid example of standard books. FOSI project is from, this is a project of IIT Bombay. Textbook companion is a collection of code for solid examples of standard textbooks. Over 1,000 TBC have been created in Scilab and Python alone. So you will be getting the solid examples of Python, Scilab, 1,000 textbook companions they are providing it. FOSI is promoting the well-established open source software, OpenFOAM, an alternative to the proprietary software. See, whenever the higher education institutions want to buy a proprietary software, it costs very high. So the institutions cannot afford. So alternatively, they can use open source softwares. Visum, an alternative to proprietary software. Aspen Plus for chemical process simulation. eSIM, an electronic design automation software, an alternative to ARCAD. EPG Patasala, it is an initiative of the MHRD under its national mission on education through ICT being executed by the UGC. The content and its quality being the key component of education. System, high quality curriculum based interactive e-content in 70 subjects across all disciplines of social sciences, arts, fine arts, and humanities, natural and mathematical sciences. So this project is providing the e-content for non-engineering subjects. Next, Consortium of Educational Communication, that is CEC, is one of the inter-university centers set up by the University Grants Commission of India. It has been established with the goal of addressing the needs of higher education through the use of powerful medium of television, along with appropriate use of emerging information communication technology. Realizing the potential power of television to act as means of educational knowledge dissemination, UGC started the countrywide classroom programs in the year 1984. For production of such programs, media centers were set up at the 6 universities. Subsequently, CEC emerged in 1993 as a nodal agency to coordinate, guide, and facilitate such educational production at the national level. Today, 21 media centers are working towards achieving this goal under the umbrella of CEC. National Mission in Education through ICT. The National Mission on Education, this is a Government of India initiative, through information and communication technology has been envisaged as a centrally sponsored scheme to leverage the potential of ICT in teaching and learning process for the benefit of all learners in higher education institutions in any time, anywhere mode. This was expected to be a major intervention in enhancing the gross enrollment ratio in higher education by 5% points during the 11th year plan period. Then learning management system. All higher education institutions will be having the learning management system. So in that learning management system, if any of the faculty who have contributed their course content to this learning management system, they can provide the details for the NAAC criteria. Next, MOOC courses, that is massive open online courses. There are around 2,800 plus institutions which are offering MOOC courses all over the world. You can register for any online course. You can participate in all the sessions. You can take up the exam. You will get the certificate. You name any course which is available in the MOOC. So under this MOOC, so India has got the most powerful MOOC course, which is called Swayam. Swayam is offering thousands of courses. The benefits of online teaching learning improves performance and productivity of OTL, allows learners to train quicker and easier, increase depth of understanding, retention of course content, feel more motivated and engaged, and more importantly, self-discipline. See, this online courses, you can get the benefit only if you are self-disciplined and self-motivated. Cost effective. OTL removes the need for costly printed course material and on-site trainers and instructors. Save time. Participants can easily update course content and manage training delivery through the LMS while learning. Don't have to rely on scheduled training. Convenience. OTL provides 24/7 access from any online computer, overcomes busy schedules and no commuting. Benefits of online teaching and learning. Improved administration. The time required to examine student work can be done more thoroughly. Ability to document and record online interactions. Maximize resource utilization. OTL should listen to the demand on limited campus infrastructure, decrease congestion on campus and parking lots. Outreach. This could give students options, reach new student markets, appeal to current students, thus increasing enrollments. Repetition. Unlike regular classroom teaching, the participants can access the content an unlimited number of times. Interaction. OTL provides improved student to teacher and student to student interaction student-centric learning environment and a great sense of correctness and synergy. Yeah, thank you all for participating in this webinar. Over to Dr. Nilesh Pandey, sir.
Sir, my PPT is visible, sir.
It's visible.
Hello.
It is visible, sir. It is visible. Okay.
Okay. So, thank you, Manjunath, sir. Thank you, Pratibha Singh, madam, Ruchi Tripathi, madam, and Amiya, sir, for giving a brief overview on the teaching learning process. So my topic is on the use of online teaching and learning process. So let's start with this. So before going into this, the questions come, what is actually the online learning method? So we can define as an online learning as a learning which includes the number of computer assisted instruction methods. So this online teaching, which we are right now noticing in this pandemic situation, is basically a faculty delivered instruction. Means the faculty, actually it is the faculty who carries out this online learning for their student, for their scholars, through the mode of the internet. So internet is very important in today's scenario. So this online instruction include the real time as well as we can say it includes the synchronized and asynchronous interaction. Synchronized instruction is basically the real time, which like this, whatever right now we are having, we can say it as a synchronized interaction program. And asynchronous instruction program, you can see when you will, as you know, we are also putting all our webinars on our YouTube social media handles and also on the Twitter. So then when you watch this program through this medium, it is actually a recorded medium, then it becomes an asynchronous method. Then in online learning method, there are actually the two parallel process which takes up in the online environment, or you can say in a virtual environment, where the students become more active and reflective learners, and the student and teachers engage in the learning process, because this online teaching learning method is basically defined by the three components, which I will later explain in my next slides. So this teachers and the faculty members or the teachers engage in the learning process through the use of technology. So the significance of technology or the use or the impact of technology have gained its importance in this present scenario. So to become more familiar with the technology is also very important, because jab tak aapko us cheez ko pata nahi hoga, we say that in Hindi, like if you are not known to that technology, you will not be able to be you are not convenient with that technology. Aap us technology se familiar jab tak nahi honge, tab tak aap uska labh nahi utha payenge. Yani ki if you are not familiar with that technology, you will not take the benefit from that technology. So going for the online learning teaching program, it is very much essential that you should be familiar with technology, the students, even the management of the institution, they should be familiar with the technology. Then comes the there are certain aspects in the online learning methods. First is the what is the advantage of learning online. Then comes the second as a advantage of teaching online. Then there are also certain challenges which are faced by the teachers, by the faculty members, by the students, by the students. So challenges which are faced by the components during the teaching online process. Now, going into the deep into the online teaching learning process, to quote some of the focus and also looking after IT medium. So as said by the Bloomberg in 2001 of quote was written by Cisco, right? Developed and designed Cisco, that is Cisco. As a either to change the earlier when we were in schools and in college and universities, we were having the traditional method of teaching using the chalk and the board. Now this system, which is now the theory that everything changes, so we see it. So it's very various system because they're evolving, they're not equipped, they're not equipped. Then there will be at the end of this decade. So there is no method of going back. So now whatever we say that traditional classroom will not be it should be eliminated, but it should be transferred because if you're not able to change it, but you should be able to update with the new and new techniques so that you can be the impact can't be diminished, the impact can be increased only. So traditional classroom has to be transformed with the digital medium. Now this diagram, you can see there is a how the emergence of education technology took place. When earlier method was writing on the leaves, then it came the postcard, then the telephone medium, then the television medium, and right now we have the internet medium. Even in internet medium, we have various aspects are there. Now earlier we used to have digital medium, audio, video, conferencing mode. Now we have generally a new term has included as a radio web. Radio web is basically for those places where the internet connectivity is not good. So the bandwidth is not good. So it is not able to play the video format, but using the radio web, you can have, at least you can listen to the audio and you can get to know more about that. So as you can see in this diagram, there is a internet which is right now prevalent in current scenario, and it has the greatest impact. Now talking about the e-learning, the blended mode. So the chalk and board, as you all know, we are all we have all seen in our past day that we have been seen our faculty member, our mentors have chalk and board, which has long ruled the classrooms. So it cannot be eliminated, but the when talking about in this COVID-19 situation where we can cannot have the physical interaction with us, which is very much risky. So it has, the emphasis has become less. So we should switch it to more of the ICT medium. So this ICT medium basically comes with the more emphasis, and it is also on demand because various institutions are now started using them who are not used further, but they have now introduced the online teaching pattern. They have introduced also online courses also. So it has become more and more interactive. Now for building an e-learning culture, this is very important for, because if you want to be build an e-learning culture, there are three components which are very much necessary for building an e-learning culture. So these three components are basically, the first one is the learner. You can call it as a students who are self-directed, self-motivated, self-regulated, and who are lifelong. Now the second component, which is also very important, is the one who develop the knowledge and skills. Without developing the knowledge and skills, it is not possible to build a e-learning culture. Then second comes is a understanding learning and its need. Then they facilitate learning culture because they are the ones, they are the instructors who actually carry out the online teaching learning patterns, and also they create a learning opportunities because they have a student can be a slow learner or rapid learner. So they are actually the persons who create the learning opportunities. The third one is very important is the administrator, because right now as we are having a webinar on the teaching and learning process, so this is administrator I call as a base one, because they are the one who provide the medium. This is the medium, like on the WebEx we are having interaction, I'm interacting with you all. So administration, like in this today's WebEx, Mr. Samuel, who is also our system analyst, is the administrator of this. So actually the administrator is a person who carries out this e-learning culture, then creating a learning environment. They provide the ICT infrastructure, and also they provide the resources for carrying out the necessary e-learning culture. Then there are certain tools for having an e-learning tools. First one is email. As you know, email is very much necessary right now. So every faculty member should have an email account. They should communicate with their students. They should communicate with their parents, and the student can submit the assignment, whatever the assignment is assigned by the teacher during the online learning process, that can be submitted by the student to the email mode. Then we have an attachment. So attachment can be given. Then we can have a paperless environment. Paperless environment is very much necessary, because increasing pollution also, we can also curb the pollution by the use of paperless environment, which can be facilitated to the email medium. Then it is also simple, and we can say it is efficient also and cost effective also. Then comes the chat. Chat is also, we can say, a synchronized medium, because it is carried out in real time situation. Then we can communicate with the students, we communicate with the parents, and also more and more students can participate in a discussion mode in thread formation, thread discussion. You must have heard there is a thread discussion. So through the medium of chat, we can have a thread discussion also. Then there will be more of collaborative learning. Then there is one more tool is online forum. Online forum is actually an asynchronous discussion forum. You can take the example from the blogs, where we can have a discussion on a particular topics related to that. So teachers, the faculty can create a discussion group. Even the teacher can post a question and request the student to comment. The student, depending upon their knowledge, depending upon their understanding, they can post their comments. Now they can even encourage the community participation also. And this collaborative learning can be fostered. And the last one in this is the feedback, because as a journalism student, most of the you should know, and I think most of you also know, that without proper feedback, communication can't be completed. Because so it is very much necessary that a feedback should come from students. Like you will be providing us feedback by asking the question related to the whatever the topics we have delivered the lecture. Then comes the web. So as you know, web is there. Most of us are well equipped with this. I'm sorry, I'm not well, so it's creating a problem. So none of this. So web is actually a range of material available. We have a Google with us. We have Yahoo with us. We can, whatever the information we need, we can access to them. Then teachers should also be this learning process is a lifelong learning process. So teachers should also get equipped with the web services to know more and more about their specific field also. So you can say web is actually a resource, and it is a method of sharing of resources. Sharing of resources means, suppose your paper has been published, then you can, that comes, you get assigned to DOI. Then if you want to have, you want to cite, or you want to take a reference, then you can have to, through the web modem. Then it is supported by the images, audio, multimedia. Then there is a video conferencing. So video, like right now, you can take the example. Right now we are having we are having a kind of video conferencing enabled with the audio medium. So you can conduct a live lecture also. You can communicate with the students, even with the parents, and it should be supported. It can be supported by the audio. Like right now, we are having a video conferencing supported with the audio medium. And then there will be a chat box also, where you can put up your question and the whiteboard. Then there will be a sharing of application. Like right now, I'm sharing my PPT with you all. So there will be a sharing of application also. and it can be recorded. As I said, key the whatever the webinar we are holding, it is getting recording on our social media handle, so it can be recorded also. Now the this one, the last is the learning management system. As Manjunath sir has already told you about in detail about learning systems, give a general idea, like it is a management of content, then tracking the students, then administrative features, then where we integrate various chat, forum, email, also reporting. So in conclusion, we can say that ICT and e-learning offers opportunity to raise the educational standard in the institutions. And there is a large range of ICT tools, because day to day we have new technology, new emergencies there. So there is a large range of ICT tools are there, and our teachers, and even not even the teacher, the students should also get equipped with that, and also they should get familiar with that. So as you know, there is only 30% of the Indian population who are actually the computer literate. So we can also bridge the gap, which is right now in our country. So we can close the gap of digital divide. So in this online teaching pattern, the involvement of teachers and parents are also very important, and also the importance of institution can't be said neglected, because they are the one who are providing the funding, who are there actually promoting, and they are training their faculty members as well as their students. So we can say the best way to maintain the connection between the online education and the value of traditional education is through the online learning delivered by the teachers. We always say ki when if you are not fully qualified, if you are not very much interested in teaching and teaching online, then this e-learning culture can't build healthy. Because to make a very much healthy e-learning culture, then we should be having the faculty and should be very much familiar with the medium they are using for online teaching. With that, now there are certain approaches to online learning. Basically, there are two types of approaches to online learning. One is synchronized learning, another is asynchronous learning. As I have told you in earlier slide, there are two types of real time means synchronized learning. And asynchronous learning is basically as per convenience of the teachers and the students. So synchronized learning is actually instruction and collaboration in real time, and it involves the tools like live chat, audio, video conferencing, like right now we are having. Then the data and application sharing, like I am sharing my PPT. Then the sharing of the whiteboard. Then virtual hand raising, like after the end of my session, you will be given a time for asking the question. So you can raise your hand through the virtual mode. There is option of raising the hand, so you can ask the question through this. So this mode, it comes under the synchronized learning method. Then joint viewing of multimedia means lots of people are watching whatever I'm presenting to my PPT. Then comes the asynchronous learning, which is asynchronous learning method are the time delayed capabilities of the internet. Like it has been recorded, so it you can watch this presentation as per your time and convenience. So it typically involves the email, the threaded discussion, the news group, and the bulletin boards, and the file attachment. So in asynchronous courses are actually the still instructor facilitated, but they are not conducted in real time. And means the teacher, the student can engage in this process as per their convenience, as per their availability. So learning does not need to be scheduled for the asynchronous learning. Here you can see the threaded discussion means it is actually a online discussion which is focused on a particular topic, in which a user post comments and or threads related to the given topic. Now in this there is talks, let's talk about the advantage of learning online. So in this advantage of learning online, there is a it is basically related to the student centered learning, where the variety of online tools are used for learning. Like you can say Google Meet is there, virtual mode, many virtual modes are there for individual learning, and also for helping the student to become more versatile. Then comes the collaborative learning. Like right now we will be having we are having a discussion, we are having a webinar on the teaching learning process. Similarly, we can have a group interaction also, which become more and more interactive and more active, because all the participants who are right now in the webinar can contribute to this process. And also they are the each and every student, likewise for the student also, they can organize their thinking and they can express their thinking with the constructed language, whatever they have learned from the online teaching learning patterns, they can construct their language. Then experimental learning is also been facilitated in the online teaching learning method. Like suppose in case of research also, for the science background also, we can facilitate through the multimedia presentation, through the use of video. Right now various yoga program are being conducted, so that is facilitated by the multimedia presentation. Now new technology can also be motivated to be kept and cooperated by the teachers and also by the students. Now this technology should be supported by the student, because if your audience, if your viewers are not equipped with this ICT medium, digital medium, then there is no sense of having the online teaching method. So it is always said ki whatever the medium you are using for online teaching pattern, it should be backed up with the skilled and trained student who are very much equipped and familiar with the teaching medium which you are using for the online teaching pattern. Now this easy, we can also say there is a easy access to the global resources. As I said, you have web, you have email, so you can have a access to global research. Then you log on to web resources, you can easily get the some of the references, some of the literature review. So it's easy access to the global resources. And also there is experimental learning, as I told, for the especially for the science medium, for the science fields, like for the chemistry, where you can have also experimental learning also. There will be accessible for the non-traditional students, means the traditional students may have difficulties in online learning, but very much medium which the faculty members are using for the online teaching pattern. So this become more of traditional students, and also with this pattern we can have a large interaction with more and more students along this online mode. Then comes advantage of teaching. So advantage of teaching online is, can be said that you can experiment with the techniques, because if you will not experiment with the techniques, you will not get into advantage, you will not get into the benefits. So it is always requested from the teacher, from the students, to kindly experiment with the techniques, because techniques are the thing which helps you, it gives you it act as a catalyst. So it is always requested to kindly have a experiment with the techniques. Like I said, there is a threaded session is there, bibliography is there, resources related to a particular topic where discussion will be happening. Then there may be a email discussion will be there. Then we can also have a like web based company, the ANA process of NAC. They are providing their academic calendar, and they are also submitting through the AQR. So they can we can say this ICT medium has allowed the institution to become a more and more active, as they post their academic calendar on their website. And also when the institution come from the AQR submission, they provide their academic calendar during the submission of AQR also. Then student have the chance to study for free, because some of the campus degree program are very much costly also. So the student have chance to study it for free, as per their time and as per their pace also. Some of the student which professor presenting madam has already told you, they are slow learner and active learner. So depending upon their pace and their time, they can study. So they become from passive learner to the active learners. So but the one most uh, one most important, for the student for getting into online teaching, have the responsibility and also self-discipline of the student is very much necessary for carrying out the online learning. And also, this online education provides a flexible learning environment. As I told you, there are three components which are very much necessary. So this online education provides you a flexible learning environment, which helps you in having a more and more of interactive session. But you should be having a good internet connection so that this medium without any disruption or without any hindrance. Now, this online degree program is also cost effective. They are actually the more cost effective as compared to computer based degree program, as most of the learning materials are provided in downloadable form. I have seen when I was studying, I have gone for one of my friends studying in MIT institution. He was having all the downloadable material. They are teaching you, they were using most of the institution who are right now in this, who are facing this pandemic situation, should also opt for the online teaching learning method. Now, there are certain drawbacks for the online educations. One is the lack of accreditation and low quality, which madam has already explained to you, and there's a little face-to-face interaction. And you can say also there is more work because you have to learn what are the mediums which you can take the help from for establishment of online learning process. Then there is an intense requirement of self-discipline. I said ki, if you are not responsible enough, you are not taking interest, then this online teaching learning will not have a possible outcome. Then there should be an intense requirement for self-direction. So some of the challenges which I already explained to you, that there should be a familiarity, you should be a familiar with the online environment, and you should have a capacity, you should be knowing so that you can use it extreme. And it should be available to the student, because if it is not available to a student, if the students are not familiar, they are not getting what teacher wants to have it, then it's of no use. So it should be being available to the student on an extended basis electronically. Then it should be providing quick feedback. As I said, communication can't be completed if there is no feedback system. Then these difficulties, whatever which the institution face, whatever the teachers face, whatever the student face during the online online teaching pattern, can be overcome with the certain things. Like I said, all the components should be familiar with the technology they are using, and also there should be a more connection, there should be more interaction with the student. And there should be we can also have structuring of online courses also. Then we can have a community in virtual environment. We can create a community as per like session we have. We can assign different topics on which teacher assign different topics to the student. If there are more number of students, they can assign a different topic and they can ask them to have a virtual interaction to find out certain outcomes. And also it facilitates, it encourages online discussion also. So we can say are involved in the learning process and learning process design expert, process implementation managers, motivators, mentors, and interpreters. In short, we can say that technology can leverage faculty time, but it cannot replace the human contact. Human contact, we can say, because this online teaching, whatever we are saying, we are using the ICT medium, but this teaching is coming from the traditional classroom. Only we are using used the digital medium, but the same old pattern still we are same as a facilitator. So this also digital media sites are there, which can also be used for the online teaching learning methods. Now, talking about the blended mode, so blended mode basically say as a virtual learning environment where the basic components of the distance learning. Earlier it was used by the IGNOU and others. Now it had integrated with the physical learning environment, means the students attend a traditional school on a part-time basis and they complete their courses online. Now this blended learning is actually a formal education in which students learn at least in the parts, means they learn in a form of cluster basis where online delivery of content is provided and instruction is given, and then the only convenience for the student is they can control, because as per their convenience, whether they are in any part of the country, they can witness this online, they can get into this, they can interact in this online medium irrespective of their place and time. So this blended mode can be explained in the form of like this. In the right side of the program, my PPT, you can see there is a diagram. This combines the face-to-face learning, then self-paced learning as per your pace. If you are active or speed, you can say you are slow learner or fast learner, depending upon the self-paced learning, and also the online collaborative learning. Then this diagram actually depicts the online teaching patterns. So which goes with the education online, then the technical structure, as I told, the various medium we use for a digital mode for online teaching learning process, humans, which will keep on of providing actual real outcome, for providing effective outcome. So a human touch is necessary, then synchronized learning, and the learning undertaken on a means of internet. Now this is online, the courses I have already seen. Then there are certain types of online education. First one is distance learning, then is homeschooling learning, blended learning, then online education, this is basically related to school services. Then online secondary education, that is the education between the elementary education and the college level education. Then the e-learning, then the m-learning. M-learning is basically the mobile learning, which is done through the use of gadgets like mobile or tablets like this. Then there are certain components of online courses. Components of online courses, basically the first is when necessary communication, like I am having the communication with you. Then what is the content delivery? The content delivery may be like the PPT I am using for delivering my content. Then the collaboration, we can have a interaction, well, like group activity for the collaboration, and the assessment. Assessment is already told by details. Now the teaching, for making the teaching technique more vibrant, there should be a mix of language which are known to our audience, which are known to the student. Like if you are using some technical jargons, if it is not known to your audience, if it is not known to your student, problem and effective online learning process, then there should be a balance of fluency and activities. And also there should be a practical and communicative feedback, and there should be a learning strategies. Then as we know, despite the very many of the potential pitfalls, majority of people have now accepted this online courses. The certain changes in the online education system, which has been will be asked to conduct some research for maximizing the benefit of the digital learning in the India, and the research and the pilot study will include finding most preferred format of e-content and also decreasing the risk of student device addiction. The second one is the online teaching tools method. The existing e-learning platform Diksha and Swayam, which is already explained by the Manjunath sir, which provides the teacher with a user-friendly and well-structured environment. So this platform will be updated with some set of tools like two-way audio conferencing, two-way video conferencing mode. Then comes the digital infrastructure. This is actually the new education policy will include some investment in creation of the public digital and infrastructure that will be utilized by the multiple platforms. So this digital infrastructure is actually a technology-based solution provided, which can help you become more updated with the time. Now, fourth one is that training for the teachers. So training of the teachers basically is where the teachers will be trained with the additional skills so that they can manage the online platform with themselves. So use of administrator will not be so much needed in the next upcoming days of the you can say era. Then there is a virtual labs are being provided, which is also been discussed to provide a virtual labs. These digital platform like Swayam Prabha and Diksha, they can have a they can create a virtual labs, and this lab will be equipped with the tools for improving the hand-on experiment. Like I said, that is basically for the keeping in view of the science fields. Now this the other one is the availability of the courses. Availability of courses means like providing of the television and community radio and radio, which will be utilized for the telecast and broadcasting purpose. That similarly, you may be knowing if you are from the journalism field, the introduction of site, which was used for giving the information. Then online assessment examination process will be there. Then also there will be digital repository. Then there will be a standard of online learning, and then blended mode of learning will be there. And also there will be a dedicated unit for digital education, which will be established by the education ministry, which will be looking after the field of education, the education technology, and also administration, e-governance, digital pedagogy, and also the IT structure. So this is all related to this for today's online teaching and learning matter. So thank you all, and I'm sorry for my health problem. I couldn't say if there is any problem in the fluency. I'm sorry for that. Thank you. Mr. Samuel, you can.
Already we have exceeded time by a half an hour's period. If at all there is one or two questions, we may take it. I request the participants, you can raise your hands. I hope there is no queries. Maybe.
May I request participants, if they have any query, they can raise their hands, or they can write the question in the question answer tab of the application.
I hope there is no queries, ma'am. Maybe you can take it forward.
Okay. Avya, sir? Okay. Moving ahead with the session, may I now request participants, if they have any doubts, I can see. Samuel, is there any question in the chat box?
Chat box doesn't have any question, ma'am. Only Q&A, there is one question. Is it countable for NAC assessment?
What is countable for NAC assessment?
If we promote students to register in Coursera and courses offered by other foreign universities besides Swayam NPTEL.
So you can refer the standard operating procedure. We have never specified any kind of specific platform. Coursera and other platforms are there for the online courses. So depending upon the definition of the metrics and depending upon the what is specified in standard operating procedure, you can definitely offer the courses or encourage your students to take participation through the Coursera or other platforms. So it is important that online courses should be encouraged, but nevertheless, you have to see the standard operating procedure, what is specified in SOP.
Online classes are very effective, no doubt, but many students are not having proper resources. In many villages, there is no proper infrastructure to receive even a mobile signal. Many poor parents are not able to provide mobile phones for their children. Due to this, many students commit suicide in Tamil Nadu. How could we stop this kind of issue?
Amir, sir? So we understand this problem of infrastructure, and we have already spoken about the limitations what we are having with a huge diversity of the institutions, their demographic location, and we will not say that this is a prescription that you should be going with the online mode, but definitely because of flexibility associated with the online mode of education, you should always try to have this in the your future plans. Like you may be planning for your resource allocation, where the things can be done with the resource allocation, how the infrastructure necessary bandwidths can be incorporated. That should be included in your institutional developmental plan, and that is the intent of these kinds of programs, where we motivate the institutions to go for the online education, because the future will be online. It's not always a face-to-face mode, because we are talking about that the education should be there with the blended mode of education. So that is where we try that this should be given a priority in your plans also.
Thank you, ma'am. I don't think so. More questions are there.
Okay. Ruchi? Okay. Now we can close the program. Before closing the program, may I propose the formal vote of thanks? So I thank our Honorable Director, Professor S.C. Sharma, for being a motivation for organizing these webinars, which are specifically designed on the basis of theme-based. So we try to have all the higher education issues in these theme-based webinars, and we conduct the webinars, and we are planning for few more webinars in coming days. So I thank our director for motivating our academics and the team. Next, I would like to thank our ICT team, including Professor Amiya Kumar Rath, the speaker of today's webinar, who very elicitly explained the guidelines for the outcome and outcome-based education, and also about the intelligence, types of intelligence. Next, other speakers of today's webinars, Dr. Manjunath Rao, Dr. Nilesh Pandey, Dr. Ruchi Tripathi. I would like to thank each one of you, all the participants. And with this, may I request our ICT team to go ahead for the closure of the program. Thank you, one and all. Thank you very much.